Good afternoon and welcome to Gardens of California. My name is Gerald Turney and I'm your host and instructor. And in this class, we examine everything about gardening from apples to zinnias and trees to turf. And we are live and you can call us with any of your questions you might have about your garden. And we'll do our best to answer your questions, whether it be a pest problem or where to grow something in the garden, how to water it, how to fertilize it, how to prune it. Any question you might have, our number is 800-339-1193. We always start the show with a list of upcoming events. So let's take a look at our upcoming events in Southern California. The Organic Edible Gardening Series, Part 2, will be at the Thornton Arboretum on November 20th. From 1 to 4 p.m. And you can call 657-278-3407 to get more information. This should be a great opportunity to learn more about organic vegetable gardening. The Orchid Festival is coming up at San Diego Botanical Gardens, formerly known as Quail Gardens, in Encinitas. That's November 21st from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. You can call 760-436-3036. Great opportunity to go down and see just a wonderful display of orchids and really unique species too, not just some of the really common stuff. Success with Succulents will be at the Manhattan Beach Botanic Gardens on November 21st from 10 to 11 a.m. And this is a free class. They have free classes every Saturday at the Manhattan Beach Garden. And you can call 310-546-1354 and let them know you're coming. They have limited space. It's free. But you need to let them know you're coming so they can plan for how many people will show up. And the Manhattan Beach Botanical Garden is a great place to go and learn about how to do more compatible gardening with our environment, how to conserve water, how to conserve your energy and your workload, because it is a low-maintenance garden, and they don't water very much, and they don't use any pest control products or other than maybe washing a plant off every once in a while. But I want to remind the students in the class that you do need to attend one garden event, either one that you've seen us highlight at the beginning of the show, or an event that you find on your own at a garden or some type of gardening event. And then you need to write that up, 1 to 2 pages, and you can email that to me. I've been emailing all our students, and so you have my email. And I want to know what you learned and what you experienced, and I want to see that that you attended and that you you learned something. It's not a big challenge. Now, previously on the show, one of the previous hosts, Frank McDonough, used to always show a plant and invite the audience to call in and identify that plant. And so I thought I'd try that today a little bit. And so I have a little plant here. Let's pull this over. And I'm actually talking about this group today. That's one of the reasons I brought it in. And let's bring this back and get a good look at it. Here are the leaves right here. Big strap leaves and these really lovely flowers. So if you recognize this plant, why don't you call us up and tell us what it is. There's no prizes, just the joy of knowing that you answered the question correctly. Really quite striking. I just picked this up yesterday as part of today's lecture. Very common. I'll go ahead and tell you right off the bat it's an orchid. But what I want to know is what genus is this? And maybe the common name or the genus. So give us a call and tell us if you recognize this plant. And I'm just going to set this over here for now. I just watered it and it's getting everything all wet. Just a little caveat, when you do pick up an orchid or a plant at a nursery, I suggest when you bring it home, you water it almost immediately, unless you can tell that it's been watered recently. They're often dry in the nurseries, especially things like this, these small flowering plants, often don't get watered very often. They're in the interior of the various garden centers. And so what I found on this one and another one I purchased yesterday is when I got home, they were dry. So I gave them a good drink. So if you recognize that, what kind of orchid that is, and of course that particular orchid is identified by its genus. And also, it's a common name. There's a common name for the genus as well. And just to digress, before we go into today's lecture, and today I'm going to lecture on orchids, and we're going to talk about the genus, the orchid genus, or it's actually the orchid family, excuse me, the Orchidaceae. There are many genera within the orchids, many, many. But I wanted to talk about what's in a name, especially a plant name. Of course, all plants that have been described and published have a species name. The species name is comprised of the genus, which is the first word, and the specific epithet, which is the second. And you can compare that to animals. That's the same for animals and insects and really any described living organism. So our Latin name is, you know, for people, is Homo sapien. Homo is the genus, and sapien is the specific epithet, and the two together are the species. Often people think that sapien is the species, when in fact, Homo sapien is the species. So that's important to keep in mind. In addition to that, there are naturally occurring varieties of various plants, and they're referred to as varieties. And then there are man-made varieties, or what we call cultivated varieties. And in fact, there may be a variety growing in a natural population of plants in the wild. And you go out and collect that variety and then propagate it and sell it. It could also be referred to as a cultivated variety because you went and collected it. But generally, cultivated varieties are created by hybridization or selection. If you go collect seed and then grow them all out, and you see one seedling is different than all the others, has some attribute or characteristic that is more advantageous or something you like. It may be a dwarf, it may be small. It may be have a bigger flower or a more colorful flower, or it may have some characteristic that's different, so you give it a new name. And one of the most obvious examples of cultivated varieties, of course, are roses. Almost all the roses you would purchase would be cultivated varieties, such as a Chrysler Imperial rose. In fact, you know, roses have been so highly hybridized for so many thousands of years that most roses are just referred to as Rosa SP. There's no species, or Rosa, and then in single quotes, it could be Chrysler Imperial or some other type of rose. Those are called cultivated varieties, or cultivars. So you have the genus and species, then you have a varietal, which could be a naturally occurring plant in a population, or you could have a cultivated variety, one that's been selected by man. So I just wanted to mention that. It's important to keep that in mind, especially for gardens, because often we're looking for a very specific plant, not necessarily any plant. And take, for instance, the Magnolia grandiflora, which is the southern magnolia. It's a beautiful tree, big, large leaves that are dark green and shiny. I've shown pictures of it in previous shows. Big, white, showy flower is evergreen. And there are a number of different varieties, and there are some cultivated varieties. There's a dwarf magnolia grandiflora called Little Jim, and that is a cultivar or a cultivated variety. Little Jim only gets to about 20 to 30 feet tall, whereas the standard magnolia grandiflora gets to 50 to 75 feet tall, perhaps even larger in its natural habitat. But here in Southern California, I don't think I ever seen it much bigger than, really about 50 feet. But yeah, I guess they can get a little bit bigger than that if they're taken care of really well. So today we're going to talk about orchids. And orchids are a lot of fun. And here in Southern California, we can grow a lot of different kinds of orchids. The orchid family is considered the largest plant family, or the largest family of flowering plants. It is estimated that there are 880 genera. That's according to the Royal Botanic Gardens in Kew, which is in England. They list 880 different genera and nearly 22,000 accepted species. And that fluctuates rather rapidly because there's a lot of taxonomy being done with orchids all the time. And generally about 800 new species of orchids are published every year. So that's a lot. The other two families that are nearly equal in the number of species compared to the orchid family would be the grass family, the Poaceae, the orchid family being the Orchidaceae, and the sunflower family, which is boy, I have to look that up. I've just forgotten the name of the Sunflower family. I'll remember it in a minute. So it's an interesting family. There's a lot of plants that we're familiar with that are orchids that you may not realize. Vanilla is an orchid. The vanilla bean is the seed pod from a vanilla plant, which is an orchid. And then some of the very common orchids, of course, that you see all the time are members of the orchid family. The large blooms that are used for corsages are typically cattleyas or cattleya hybrids. And since the introduction of the tropical species of orchids in the 19th century, in the 1800s, more than 100,000 hybrids and cultivars or cultivated varieties have been introduced into the trade have been created. And many of those, of course, are probably no longer propagated. What really drives the nursery industry and orchid growers is being able to introduce new varieties. And so they want new showy flowers or something, really heavily scented or something about it that's going to really drive the sales. As years go by, those varieties may not be, they get supplanted by newer varieties. And so, in fact, that's generally true of the entire nursery industry, is they're always looking for new varieties of any plant material to introduce that spur sales. And so there's always a push to develop and hybridize new cultivars. Now, one of the more common of the genera within the orchid family is Cattleya, or Cattleya. And there are about 42 species of Cattleyas, and they are native from Costa Rica to tropical South America, so they're widely distributed in the tropics. They occur in all colors except blue and black. And this one you see here is a white Cattleya, almost certainly a hybrid, probably. It's just a photograph showing the standard kind of Cattleya appearance or what a Cattleya looks like. The typical flower has three what we call narrow sepals and three usually broader petals. Let's bring that picture back up full screen and I'll show you what I'm talking about. Now, you can't see the sepals because they're actually shown, you can just see the tips. This is a sepal here, and that's probably a sepal there. The sepals, well, here's the sepal. Well, it's hard to say, this is the sepal here as well. Sepals cover up the whole flower when it's in bud form, and then there are three petals, and there are two petals that basically look similar to each other, and here's one petal, and here's another petal, and then the third petal is the lip, and this is the lip, and that's a petal, and these can be marked, they can have various markings, they can have specks, and they can have a frilly margin. It all depends on how they've been hybridized. Then Cattleyas can be hybridized with a lot of different genera. And many of the Cattleya-type orchids that you might purchase to grow in your own home are actually hybrids. They're commonly crossed with a handful. So let's talk about some of those. Lelia. Let's take a look at number three, and we'll take a look at Lelia. I'll bring this up full screen. Lelia is a genus of orchid, and easily crosses with Cattleya. And when it's crossed with Cattleya, it's referred to as LC, Lelia Cattleya. They tend to make the lip elongated and closed like a cone. And then that gracefully opens into a full lip of the blossom. And you get a lot of violet shades from Lelia. So that's what it adds when you cross Lelia with Cattleya. And this is a species we see in the back, Lelia anceps. And of course, Lelias are a lot of fun to grow just on their own, just species. And some collectors prefer just species rather than growing the fancy hybrids. So that's, depends on your taste and what you want to grow. If you want to have a pure species collection, that's really a precious thing to have. And then you make your own process if you want and grow your own seed, which is really a challenging thing. The other common genus that is crossed with Cattleya is Brassavola. And Brassavolas, let's take a look at a Brassavola number 4. And Brassavolas, I'll bring this up full screen. You can see this is a rather interesting looking orchid. And what you get from crossing with a Brassavola is a fringed or feathered or ruffled lip. And it expands the lip of the blossom. And the most imposing Cattleya hybrids almost always have Brassavola in their background. And when you see these sold, and you look at the little tag, it'll say BC on it, which means Brasso Cattleya. So they give it a kind of that name. If it includes Lelia, if you took a Lelia Cattleya, an LC, and crossed it with a Brassavola, it would then be a BLC, which would be a Brasso Lelia Cattleya. And you'll see this on the tags when you go look at a nursery. If you look at the tag, it'll say BLC or it'll say LC. Or if it's a species, it'll give you the Cattleya species name. In addition to that, there is another genus. There's Sophronitis, and we can take a look at that. That's photograph number 5. And this is a tiny flame-colored orchid that introduces the most intense red color to its descendants, and many crimson and scarlet Cattleyas betray Sophronitis in their ancestry. It's also used to minimize Cattleya hybrids, so you get a much smaller flower, and they're referred to as SLC, Sophrolalia Cattleya. Now, Sophronitis was recently merged into Cattleya, and after being expanded to include most of the Lelias. So you can see the taxonomy actually fluctuates, and people change things around a lot. Now, so if you have 3 genera in your cross, they use that system. They use, LC or BLC or SLC to indicate the 3 genera that are in the hybrid for that Cattleya. If you go to a 4th genus, they start creating whole new names. And so if you combine the 3 above, the 3, Sophronitis, Brassavola, and Lelia, with Cattleya, now you have 4 genera in the cross. And this used to get the name Portinaria, or Portinera. And these were they're not as popular as BLCs or SLCs, but there were some really quite beautiful ones, and especially with a light green to magenta color in the flower. They were usually smaller than BLCs, they're a little bit bigger than SLCs. But just recently, Sophronitis, as I mentioned earlier, was merged with Cattleya, and so now Portinera is not used anymore. In addition to that, there's another one if you cross a BLC with Epidendrum, and we do have a picture of an Epidendrum. Epidendrums are real fun to grow as well. And that would be number 18. That's farther down our list. We could take a quick look at Epidendrum. One of the easier orchids to grow outdoors. And there we go. Now, if you cross a BLC with an Epidendrum, you end up with what we call Yamadera. And here's the Epidendrum. They're really pretty. They're little, very thin stems with leaves that are alternate or opposite. And then these little clusters of flowers at the end of long inflorescence. So, Epidendrum appears to increase both flower yield and the intensity of color. And with the recent discovery, recently it was discovered that Yamadera was registered as Adamera prior to that. So, actually, now they're calling the Yamaderas Adamera. So, sometimes you're going to see, a name on the orchid. If you want to know the history of that orchid, you may actually have to just search it on Google or Yahoo and see what type of hybrid that is. It'll also give you a better idea, perhaps, how to grow it, because depending on its ancestry, it may tolerate a little more cold or tolerate a little more heat, or a lot of orchids have to go through a dry season in order to do well. So that gives you a little idea about how orcas are hybridized all the time. And I just want to remind our viewers that we're live and on the air, and you can call in with a question if you have one at 1-800-339-1193. And here's our plant of the day. See if you can figure out what this is. If you know this plant, give us a call. I can pull this over here. If you know this plant, give us a call. It's an orchid. You can tell us the kind of orchid it is, the genus, or its common name. And I see I'm getting everything all wet. But that's okay. It's a plant show. Gotta fetch some water. So, Cattleyas can also be crossed with a large number of other, what we call allied genera. I see I got water on my glasses. And you can actually end up with as many as 8 different genera in a cross. By crossing once and then crossing again and crossing again, you can end up with 8 different genera, which is quite amazing. Now, Cattleyas and their hybrids in general, they need to be grown in whether protected from frost or cold weather. In fact, you don't want to get them below 55 degrees at night and about 80 to 90 degrees during the day. So typically, most of the Cattleyas are really greenhouse orchids, although some of the Cattleyas that are from the highlands, that are native to the tops of mountains in like Costa Rica or in Central America, they'll tolerate a lot more cold. And so some of those Cattleyas you can actually grow outdoors all year. And they'll probably do better in a greenhouse where you can keep them warm in the winter. And of course, a hard freeze would probably take them out anyway. So the tropical orchids are pretty tender. Now, orchids, and I forgot to mention this, orchids actually occur on all the continents, and there are terrestrial orchids as well. The orchids, Cattleyas and all those things that it crosses with, and some of the others we're going to look at, are mostly epiphytic orchids from the tropics. And they grow in the nook of a branch, the crotch of a branch in a trunk where organic matter has accumulated, and they're not growing in soil. And I'll talk about that more in a moment, because when you grow orchids, you don't grow them in a regular potting mix. You don't grow them in soil. You grow them mostly in something that drains very, very readily. Generally, you want your humidity around Cattleyas to be between 50 to 80%. So that kind of does dictate mostly a greenhouse. They do quite well along the coast, where the humidity stays quite a bit higher than in the hot inland valleys. I have a question: does anyone work with orchids? And a lot of people work with orchids. I'm not sure what the question really means. I guess you could say someone who works with orchids is an orchidist. Generally, you're going to water Cattleyas twice a week during their growth and flowering period, and once a week during their period of rest. And Cattleyas are orchids that can and should get dry between water after blooming. So after they flower in the flower and you cut the flower off, then you go to watering once a week. When you see a new pseudo bulb or a new growth coming up out of the pot, then you can start watering twice a week. And people do tend to fertilize orchids fairly heavily. They're considered high feeders. There's really nothing in the soil. They're so different than regular plants, especially the tropical orchids or the epiphytic orchids. They don't have regular root systems. Those roots are mostly just holding them onto the tree or something. And so a lot of orchid people fertilize twice a month, or at least once a month. They give them a weak fertilization every 2 weeks, or a regular fertilization once a month. And then you probably want to leach them real good, too. If you're fertilizing that much, occasionally you want to really drench them and leach them of any accumulated salts. Most of the orchids cannot take full sun. They can be grown in 50 to 60% shade or under 50 to 60% shade cloth. They can take full sun in the early morning, so you can grow them on the eastern exposed part of your home, so they get morning sun, but then they're going to be protected from the full sun in the afternoon, especially in the hot summer months. If you're right along the coast, you might be able to get away with growing them in the full sun, especially in the spring and the fall, and even get away with a little bit in the summer. It really But on a really, really hot day, you're going to have to be careful because it'll burn. Now, and most cattleyas are grown in fir bark with hardwood charcoal and perlite. And generally, they're not really considered really terrestrial at all. So they use a kind of a coarse orchid bark rather than a medium orchid bark, and they may mix in charcoal and perlite as well. Seedlings, cattleya seedlings are usually grown in a more fine bark. Of course, what you try to do is make sure they don't dry out, so you keep them in a slightly wetter mix. The more dense the mix, or the finer the mix, the more it's going to hold water and stay wet longer. So the mature cattleyas are potted in coarsing potting material, much coarser than the seedlings. When a plant has at least six mature pseudobulbs, and we'll look at pseudobulbs in a minute, then you can put it into a larger pot. And now if you do divide, you generally want to always retain at least three what we call pseudobulbs. Always keep the plant humid and shaded, and dry the roots until the new growth is seen after blooming. So watering once a week should be sufficient after blooming. Now, let's take a quick look at cymbidiums. And cymbidiums are probably the easiest orchid for people to grow in Southern California. And you can grow them outdoors, and typically grow them outdoors year-round. So let's take a look at various colors of cymbidium. Here we have a big cymbidium bloom right behind me. Let's take a quick look at this. And what's nice about this is you can actually see the three sepals. Here's a sepal, there's a sepal, there's a sepal. This is a petal, and then, of course, the third petal, which is the lip. And then this is the pistil and stamen. It's the sexual parts of the flower right there. So this is a typical cymbidium bloom. They come in a wide variety of colors. It's also referred to as the boat orchid. In terms of species, there are 52 species of cymbidiums that have been described, perhaps even more at this point in time. The genus is distributed in tropical and subtropical Asia, such as India, China, Japan, Malaysia, the Philippines, and Borneo. It's also found in northern Australia, usually growing in cooler climates at high elevation. So actually, that's why cymbidiums are so easy for us to grow, is that they are fairly tolerant of cold temperatures. Now, they'll freeze. If we get down into the 20s, it'll damage the plant. And the first thing that gets damaged in the winter are the flower buds. So if you get a cold night down to 28 or in that low of the temperature, it can freeze off all the flowers. It may not damage the leaves at that temperature. If it gets any colder than that, you'll actually freeze leaves. Now, it typically doesn't kill the plant. Whereas if you got one of the other orchids, some of the more tender orchids, that cold, it would kill it. And I've seen some of my orchids killed because I left them out cold nights. They have what we call sympodial growth, which means they have a bulb, a pseudobulb, and then another one comes, and another one comes, and another one comes. And the flower spikes can be as long as about 3 feet in the longest, or they can be very short because there's so many hybrids and cultivated varieties that they come in a wide range of lengths. The flower spike or the raceme grows from the base of the most recent suitable, but in fact, when you're in during the summer months, when if you're watching it, all the new bulbs that come up, generally you'll get a spike for every new bulb. That's a general rule of thumb when you're talking about cymbidiums. They range in color from white, green, yellowish green, cream, yellow, brown, pink, red, really a tremendous range of colors. It can survive cold temperatures as low as 45 degrees. Actually, it can survive colder than 45 degrees. They're easy to grow in Southern California. They will do best if they're protected from frost. So if they're up against the house or somewhere like that, or if they're in a shade house, I only had one hard freeze on mine many years ago. So they also tolerate a summer heat, up to 100 degrees or even hotter, for short periods, and they can withstand temperatures as low as 29 degrees. During the spring and fall, the growing season is spring, summer, and fall, the plants should have as many hours of filtered sunlight as possible, and generally about 50% shade is just right for them. And so shade cloth is really excellent. And you can just have benches and build a structure to spread your shade cloth, and that is perfect. Now, if you don't have a little structure to put them in, to shade them, then the east side of a tall tree where they get morning sun and afternoon shade, that would be okay. If you put them too far under the canopy, they won't get enough light. In fact, one of the ways you can tell if your cymbidiums are getting enough sun and are going to flower, if they don't get enough sun or bright light, they flower poorly or not at all. And so the foliage should be kind of a yellowish green and not a dark green. If the foliage on your cymbidiums is really dark green, it means it's not getting enough light and it's not likely to flower well or at all. So, and of course, it's getting too much sun, then it'll be bleached and it also can burn in the hot afternoon sun. Actually, here in my notes, they say the color of the green should be a golden green. The potting for cymbidiums is a little heavier. It's a heavier potting mix than you use for a lot of the other cattleyas in the related genera. And they use a small bark or a medium bark rather than a coarse bark. They use fir or pine bark. Perlite, redwood compost, do you see? That's going to make it a little heavier mix. Coarse peat moss, sand, crushed volcanic rock, oak leaf mold, dolomite. And so you can see they end up with a heavier mix, and I'll show you that mix momentarily. During the warm months, when they're actively growing, cymbidiums can handle copious amounts of water. I water mine only twice a week. I tend to grow them in larger pots. Not really large. I got tired of growing them in the tubs because they got to be too hard to handle. So I have a limit to my pot size on my own cymbidiums, just for convenience sake. But the bigger the pot, the less often you have to water, really. And I try to water in the summer twice a week, but they can be watered as much as three times a week. I don't believe that's necessary. I fertilize my cymbidiums once a month, at least I try to. And I just use a regular orchid food. I'm using a 20-20-20 now. You know, a long time ago, when I first started growing orchids, cymbidiums particularly, about 30 years ago, the standard fertilization regime was to give them a high nitrogen, a low phosphorus, low potassium a fertilizer from January to July, and starting in July to give them high phosphorus, high potassium, low nitrogen. And that's a flowering fertilizer. When you have low nitrogen and higher phosphorus and potassium, that encourages blooming and flower production. If you put a lot of nitrogen on some plants, they grow like crazy and they don't flower a whole lot. And people pretty much stopped doing that. There was a one particular grower that really pushed that, and then they stopped doing it quite a long time ago. So nowadays, you just fertilize once a month with a 20-20-20, and your cymbidium should do really, really well. So, now the tips actually turn brown quite frequently on cymbidiums, and that is typically due to a salt burn. And if you're using water that's greater than 500 parts per million of dissolved solids, you can expect to get some tip burn on your cymbidiums. I'll show you that momentarily. And you can leach that out by really drenching them. When you water, you want to water the point that's running out the bottom of the pot. That's true of all your potted materials. And so, as I said, in the summer, 2 to 3 times a week, once a week or less in the winter months. And, of course, if it rains, not at all, if they're outdoors. It is generally true that larger plants will produce more flowers than smaller ones. But if you cut the plant too big, then that might not be as effective. Let's see here. Now, when do you take your cymbidium and repot? Now, let's take a look at a cymbidium real quick. This is one I actually bought a year or two ago, and I haven't. You can see they're a little big. They don't make good house plants. They're really an outdoor plant, not a greenhouse plant. Oh no! I broke off my flower spike. I knew that was going to happen if I dragged this in. Did I break off another one? Okay. Here it is. Okay, so let's take a look here. Here's the spike right here. Here's a flower spike. Here are the new here are the buds, and so the sepals now are closed, have it closed up, and when it opens up, as that picture I showed you, the sepals will pull back and the petals will be so. So here are the tender new buds. These are very, very delicate. You do anything to these and you'll damage them at this point in time. And in fact, I'll show you what happened. And I don't know where it is, but I broke this one in half. They're very delicate. Let's take a look at this one and I'll show you what I did to it. Let's see this one right here. It's broken right there. So that probably happened when I was bringing it in today. So these are the buds, and they'll probably be opening up in the next 2 to 6 weeks, maybe even 2 to 4 weeks. And then what I wanted to show you was, here, let me get my hand shears, something I haven't done on this plant that I should have done previously. Now, whenever you prune orchids, you want to clean your shears with a disinfectant, and then do that between every plant. Now, it's not so important when you have a dead, dry part, but here's last year's flower spike, and I'm going to cut that out because I should have done a long time. There were two flower spikes on it last year. There are three on it this year, so I guess I'm doing okay with this one. They do need that bright light. Now, if you look at it, you can see on this leaf that it got a little too much sun, and this is what happens when they get too much sun. They're kind of bleached out right in here. This is from an excessive full sun. They can burn like this, too, from the sun. This could also be a symptom of a virus infection. Now, I'll talk about that more in a minute. So, this one doesn't show a lot of tip burn. A lot of the tips look fine. I don't see a lot of tip burn, which is nice. But here's on this side, we see a couple of leaves. The tips have turned brown. And this is generally due, see this tip right here? This is generally due to salt burn. If it's really extensive, it could be virus infection, too. So it's really important between plants that you clean your hand shears with either Lysol or a weak alcohol solution or even a very weak bleach solution. But I don't use bleach because my hand shears cost too much and it ruins them. So I either use alcohol or I use Lysol. Now, we talked about pseudobulbs, and that's what this is right now here at the base. We look right here. This is a bulb, and it's referred to as a pseudobulb. It's quite fat. And here are the strap leaves that are coming off of it. And as you can see, the spike originates at the base of the pseudobulb. And every time it grows a new bulb, it grows, here's a new one growing right here. And it's got a little spike, a new spike growing right at the base of it. Here's the spike, and here's the new bulb right here. Right in here, here's the new bulb. You know, one of the things I like to do is try and keep them cleaned up so they look a little better. So I pull off any of the dead leaves as often as I can to make them look a little better. And now this here, let's see if I can get this out. Come on. It's not cooperating. Last time I brought a plant in to work on it, it didn't cooperate at all. But this one's going to cooperate a little better. So here's a little piece of bamboo. It's a bamboo stake. This is used to tie up these spikes. The spikes get, they can grow sideways and they can grow all over the place. When they're about this age, or a little younger actually, it may be getting a little old, you can take this, you shove it down in there. Don't worry, you're not going to hurt the roots very much. Shove it in, good, and then you can take this and you can tie it up. Now you can use a variety of things to tie it up. You can use plant tape, which is quite effective. Or you can just use a little piece of wire. Or, you know, here's a little plait tie or a little tie. This didn't go in quite the direction I wanted, so I'm going to try it again. Come on. There we go. Well, it still wants to go back like that. So typically, you need to tie it off at maybe one or two spots. Now, by tying this off, it's going to keep the spike straight, and it'll be much more showy. So you can see here, I've tied it off to this. Now, let me turn this loose a little bit. Here's the stake here, and here's a tie. And now, if we go back to a wider view, you can see that this spike will now be straight, and the flowers will be displayed up here, rather than having this spike grow sideways and all over the place. So this is a Cymbidium orchid. This is a 1 gallon pot. I like to keep mine in up to about a 3 gallon pot. As they get crowded and start developing what we call back bulbs, because eventually the leaves will fall off these pseudobulbs and it will become what we call a back bulb, then it's time to repot the Cymbidium. Now I'm going to show you how to do that momentarily, but let's set this down. So this is a Cymbidium. You grow these outdoors, morning sun, protected from the afternoon sun, water once to twice a week, depending on the season, fertilized once a month, and they bloom like crazy. And they can be in a million colors. Always clean your shears between plants when you're working on them. There's one other thing that people like to use, and maybe these little clips. Now, this is probably not quite big enough to grab that. So, but this, I brought this in to show you too. It's like it's just a little kind of a clip or a clamp that you can also use to tie up the spikes so they go straight. Because they don't go sideways, then they're no pain. Now, on the plant, those flowers can last for a long time, 1 or 2 months. If you cut them, they'll last for a good 4 weeks inside the house. And if you cut them, you want them straight. If they're going sideways and all the flowers off, when you cut them, they don't look right when you bring them inside. So it's really important to tie up your spikes when they're young and they're still a little flexible. If you want to cut them and bring them inside for cut flowers. If you let them just grow all over the place, then it's harder to use them as cut flowers. Cymbidiums, and let's take a look at another genus, which is Oncidium. Oncidiums are fun to grow. Here's an Oncidium right here, and I'm going to go ahead and keep the plate I've got. And Oncidiums have a really, really nice. There are about 330 species of Oncidium, and let's take a look at the tag here on this one. I just bought this one. Let's see, move it over just a little bit like that. And this is called, it's a sweet sugar calendar. So that's the cultivated variety of this Oncidium. Oncidiums typically are yellow flowered. The species are native from Mexico and the Caribbean and parts of southern Florida and to South America. They usually occur in seasonally dry areas, so they can actually go through a dry period, just like the cattleyas. After they bloom, you want to not water them as frequently, let them go through a kind of a dry area. They also have what we call pseudobulbs. These bulbs right here are called pseudobulbs. Those are actually water storage organs. They store water for the dry period. A lot of these, you know, these are mostly epiphytic. They grow in on trees and up in the canopy of the tropical forest. Well, there's periods when you don't get any rain for a month or several months. They have a dry season in these tropical forests. And so these are adapted to going without water for some period of time. And then we need to mimic that after they bloom. They come in typically yellow is the most common color you see on Oncidiums, but they also come in shades of red, white, and pink. I see some that are kind of brownish. The petals are often ruffled, and if you notice, these are a little bit ruffled on this one. The temperature, most Oncidiums and their hybrids enjoy intermediate temperature ranges, 75 to 85 degrees, and 60 to 65 degrees at night. So this is going to be a tough one to grow outdoors you can go outdoors during the summer if it's not getting direct sun. Onsidiums should be become mildly dry between waterings. Generally, they require more water while the new shoot is growing and less once the bulb is formed. Fertilize your plants at least once a month. And now, onsidiums like a fairly high humidity, 40 to 50%. And repot at least every 2 years, and that's generally true of the cymbidiums. You usually repot cymbidiums every 2 to 3 years. I see we have a phone call. Let's go to our first caller. Terry, calling from South Pasadena. You're on the air.
Yeah, I have a question. My boyfriend gave me an orchid, and I wanted to know where I can grow it in my condominium.
Okay, do you know what kind of orchid that would be?
Oh, it's similar to the one you're showing right now.
You mean our mystery plant?
Yes.
Okay. Well, let's pull this over and take a look at it. Then what the orchid you're probably talking about is the moth orchid, or the Phalaenopsis. Here it is right here.
Mm-hmm.
And these are extremely common now. You can buy them almost anywhere, almost any garden center. Phalaenopsis, like our orchids, they need enough light to continue growing and blooming, but they can't take full sun. So usually an eastern exposed window is good. I water my Phalaenopsis once to twice a week. I try to fertilize them at least once a month or up to twice a month.
Mm-hmm.
And then they're repotted in a medium orchid bark. Let's take a look at temperature range. They're extremely tender compared to some of the others. They'll be killed if you keep them outdoors in the winter.
Okay.
And because their natural habitat, most of them are epiphytic, which means they grow on top of growing trees on branches. They typically, of course, lose a leaf as they grow a leaf, but if you're keeping humidity up, they can have as many as 10 leaves on them. This one right here has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and you notice the oldest one is already starting to wither a little bit, and so that's natural. That one will wither and fall off as it grows a new leaf. The flowers can last up to 2 months or longer. They're not usually cut as a cut flower, because they last so long on the plant, and the plant is small and easily brought indoors. So while it's blooming, you can display it in your home in a prominent location because they're so attractive and so beautiful. And then after it blooms, or periodically, you need to get it back where it gets enough full sun. Do you have a spot that during the summer it would get morning light and then afternoon shade?
Yes, I do.
That would be perfect for the summer, outdoors. You could go ahead and get the morning light and then the afternoon shade. But as soon as we start getting cold, we're starting to get down in the 40s now, in a lot of areas of Southern California. Now you need to bring it indoors and put it in a well-lit window, such as an eastern exposed window. And you have to be very careful. They're very sensitive to the full sun as well. If you put it in a southern window or a western window, and it's a warm day, today is a very warm day, and the sun will burn the leaves. So avoid direct sun in the afternoon, but bright light as much as possible.
Oh, well, thank you so much for answering my question. Thank you. I enjoy your show.
Well, thank you for calling. So there it is. Our mystery plant is a Phalaenopsis, or moth orchid. And I'm sure many of you knew that. Phalaenopsis come in a wide variety of colors. And let's see, on colors, really they come in so many different colors. Let's look at some of the colors that you can see for Phalaenopsis. Let's look at some of the photographs. We'll bring this one up. This is Sojo Yucatan. Bring that up full screen. There you go, and it's very similar to the one we have here on the table today. And this is the typical form of the Phalaenopsis. And we'll just run down and take a look at some of the other colors. Number six is actually a pure white Phalaenopsis. They come, you can get them in miniatures, and you can get them quite large as well. Number eight is kind of a more brown one. This is Barbara Muller with a craft with Joanna. And then number nine is a purple blotched Phalaenopsis. Let's take a look at number nine. So you can see you get all these different patterns, and they're, you know, all these different colors. They're always quite striking. And the blooms last for a long time, and they're fairly inexpensive. I only paid $11 for this Phalaenopsis at Osh. So, you know, $11 for a plant that will flower for me for about 2 months. And if you've got a good spot for it, it will be blooming. My problem is I end up with too many of them. So, there you go. That's Phalaenopsis and the moth orchid. And they are very tender. They are probably the most tender of all the common orchids we grow. If you leave these outside at night during the winter months, it will kill them. The only one you can easily grow outside during the winter months are the cymbidiums. And let's see where we are in our notes. We talked about Oncidium, and we talked about the temperatures for Oncidiums. 75 to 85 degrees during the day and 60 to 65 degrees at night. So you can see, if you live right along the coast, you actually have the best environment for growing orchids. If you're in a hot inland valley, it can be a little bit of a challenge. But if you can find that just that right spot, you can get away with it. They do enjoy a moderate humidity, about 40 to 50%. And you do need to repot them about every 2 years. And that's generally true of most of your orchids. You can repot on a 2 to 3 year schedule. You want to repot them when the new shoot is 2 to 3 inches tall or when the new roots start to grow. Keep the divisions in clumps of 3 to 5, and that's generally true of any orchid that you're repotting. You always want at least 3 pseudobulbs. If you go with one, it'll probably grow and survive, but it's going to take a long time to really become a big plant and flower, and you might not survive. Usually for Oncidiums, you use a medium to fine fir bark, and again, this is the Oncidium that I showed you just a minute ago. I'll set that there. Take a look at that. And generally, now, one of the things about the pseudobulbs is if you're wearing them enough, they'll be smooth and firm and full. And as they age, they may start to wrinkle. But if the new ones wrinkle, that means you're not watering enough, especially on cymbidiums. I've noticed that quite clearly on cymbidiums, that they tend to shrivel and wrinkle if they're not getting enough water. Now, another really nice group of orchids are the dendrobiums. And we can take a quick look at the dendrobiums. Let's take a look at a photograph, either 16 or 17. Here we go. Let's bring that up full screen. And you can see this the dendrobiums, there are about 1,200 species of dendrobium. Dendrobium, of course, is a genus. They're native to Asia, the Philippines, Borneo, Australia, New Guinea, New Zealand. Most grow into long, reed-like stems, which, and I don't have a dendrobium with me today, but they are. They're long canes or stems with the leaves, and then they send off a long spike at the top. The canes are evergreen, usually flowering in the second year, and can continue to flower for a number of years. So they're a lot of fun, but they really are mostly a greenhouse orchid. They grow quickly in the summer, but then they'll stop growing in the winter. And the dormant buds erupt into shoots from the base of the pseudobulb mainly in the spring, and for some species in the autumn. Now, the other one that's kind of fun to grow is Epidendrum. And we can take a look at, we looked at the Epidendrum photograph already, but we can bring that up again. Epidendrums are abbreviated Epi. They're native to the American continent and from South Carolina to Argentina. Most are to be found in the Andes at altitudes between 1,000 and 3,000 meters. Their habitat varies from humid jungles to dry tropical forests, from sunny grassy slopes to cool cloud forests. And they are quite varied in flower size and appearance, and dendrobiums are quite easily grown outdoors in Southern California, so that's a really nice orchid to grow. They have very small flowers, the ones that you typically see in Southern California. The other fun orchid to grow are the Papilpidiums. And these are the lady slipper orchids. And we can take a look at number 19 and get an idea of what I'm talking about. And you can see, here's the part that they, you know, that's this is the lip, and that's why they call that a lady slipper. It looks like a, you know, part of a shoe. Here, here are the petals, or and then that's a, probably a sepal up behind. There are about 80 accepted species, some of which are actually natural hybrids, to China, India, Southeast Asia, and the Pacific Islands. These are actually semi-terrestrial, growing in humus and other material on the forest floor. So these are not epiphytic. And typically, so when you grow papilledipediums, then you use a heavier mix, almost a soil-type mix. Let's see. So it's not, you don't grow these in fir bark. You grow these in a special mix for papilledipediums. Let's see. So generally, papilledipediums are repotted much more often than the other orchids. They're repotted every year, even up to every 6 months. And so at least every 2 years, but annually would be better. They do not have bulbs or fleshy stems to store moisture and nutrients. They're usually a fine fir bark, peat moss, and perlite, so it's a much heavier mix than the other orchid mixes. They're usually watered about twice a week. They need good light, as all the orchids do. They need a bright light in order to flower, so an eastern exposure. But again, they'll burn in the afternoon of hot sun. And now the flower can last, just like many of the orchids, the flower can last for several months. They actually start forming clumps of plants, and you can separate those and propagate more plants if you want, or put them in successfully larger pots and get a clump rather than just a single plant. I'm just looking at some of these notes here and see. So those are the most common orchids that are grown in Southern California. Cattleyas. You can get away with them, cattleyas, and although cattleya hybrids, especially along the coast, but they do need higher humidity. That's hard to keep up in outdoors. One of the tricks is to put rocks in a tray and set them on that, and to keep water in that tray. You don't want the pot sitting right in the water and having wet feet all the time. But that will raise the humidity around the plant. That's a common trick to do for houseplants in general. Works very well for orchids. But then you have to be careful not to let them freeze during the winter months. So they need to be in a protected location, or you need to bring them indoors into a brightly lit room or a windowsill. And eastern exposure is one of the best. And then, so you got cattleyas, then you have the phalaenopsis, which are probably one of the, very inexpensive, very easy to grow, but they don't tolerate any cold. You have oncidiums, which are fun to grow. And then the cymbidiums and the dendrobiums, and those are just a sampling of some of the genera. There's 880 different genera of orchid. And if you become a real orchid enthusiast, then you'll probably end up building a greenhouse. Now, what I wanted to do today was demonstrate and show you how to repot a cymbidium orchid. And I'll show you this orchid right here. Let me set this out of my way. I brought one in from my backyard that is not looking so good in a variety of ways. I mean, it's a little on the small side. It's got a lot of tip burn, either from the salty water, the hard water that it gets watered with regularly. But this guy has a lot of back bulbs. And let me tip this over or see if I can pull this out. I'm lucky it'll pop right out. There we go. Pops right out. It's cooperating today. Okay, so I pulled this out. And whenever I'm going to repot cymbidium, I start looking at it, and I look for a natural place in the plant that I can pull it apart or cut it apart. And here's a nice spot. Right here. Here's a nice, right in here, right there. That's a nice spot. Now, got a little problem here that the ants were living. I got a little part of Argentine ant in this spot. And I don't bother to control Argentine ants in my backyard. I can only control them in my house. So I'm going to have a whole lot of ants all over the place while I'm doing this. That's okay. They don't bite. But right here, this is what you call a back bulb. This is a bulb where the leaves have come off. When you start accumulating a lot of back bulbs in the center of the plant, most of your growth is on the outside of the pot. It is time to repot the plant. So now, you can either just try and push, you know, rip it apart with your own strength, or you can take your shears and cut it apart. Now, they have a very interesting root. Here's the root, and it's a very thick, fleshy root, but if you cut into it, it's got a, you know, it's completely different than typical roots on what most people see on, like, a tree or bushes. But let's see if we can just start pulling this apart and just start whacking it in half. We'll just cut into it here. Once you cut it, then sometimes it'll just start to pull apart. There we go. Reach in here and make a couple more cuts. Make it a little easier. And just work it apart. I guess these ants didn't expect me to repot this plant. This isn't unusual for Argentine ants to get into your pots. This is a perfect little place for them. There we go. Let me close that part. And you can see, you know, you have to spend a little bit of energy on these guys. There we go. Now, pull this part into two clumps. Now, I have given myself a rule that I'm not going to take one plant and turn it into a whole bunch of plants. And what you want to do is shake off all the old mix and get rid of a whole bunch of the roots. Any roots that will just come off easily. And this is a nice clump. It's got two or three of the green bulbs. Now, this plant isn't in a great shape. These are awfully small bulbs. And maybe that's just the nature of this cultivar. But I don't need so many of these back bulbs. And so I'm just going to break them off. Break a few of these off. I only want like two or three of the back bulbs. Your rule of thumb is always at least three pseudobulbs when you're repotting. Let me see if I can just get in here. Trim some of this off. You just like sort of twist them off like that. Now, if you're a real nut and you want to propagate every single bit of the plant, you can actually grow a plant from this. You put it in a pot, you cover it up, it'll grow a new bulb right off the base. Like a 4-inch pot, you put it all the way, you almost bury the whole thing, and you don't need the root at all on it, and that will actually turn into a new plant. But that's how you end up with way too many plants. So I always have this rule of thumb that I'm only going to produce one plant from one plant. That way, it'll control how many plants I'm growing. And then you can clean up all these dead leaves, all the brown growth on the bulbs. Pull it away. Now these back bulbs are firm and hard. If they're mushy and they're just they're rotted, then you definitely want to get rid of them, because they will eventually rot and die away. So now that's a nice clump, and that can be put it back into a 1-gallon pot. You can put that into this would be a nice size for a 1-gallon pot. And cymbidiums can be grown in ones or larger pots. And let me just show you some of the pots. This looks like about an 8-inch pot, And I like a shallow pots rather than a deep pot because they use a lot less potting mix. So you don't need that deep pot for a Cymbidium orchid. It's much better to have a shallow pot. And now this one, if we clean this up a little bit, this is the one I'll go ahead and put into that 8-inch pot. This is going to require a little more cleanup. But you do want to get rid of all the old potting mix. Shake it all off. And you can see how different these roots are. They're not, they're fleshy roots, and they've got this little thin center, the steel. There's an awful lot of back bulbs on this, so we've got to get rid of those. I just pull them off. And then cleaning. I like to get rid of any old dead leaves or sheaths that are wrapping around it. That's a good place for scale insects to hide. I better put on my glasses so I can see better what I'm doing. Okay, let's see. There's a lot of bulbs in here. I'm still pulling away these old bulb back bulbs. Let's see. I just wiggle it, make sure I'm getting all that. And eventually I'm just going to wiggle it apart. There we go. That's nice. That's a nice clump. That's a nice clump to repot with. Now when I put it into a pot, I don't necessarily just put one clump into a pot. You know, if I want to get a nice showy plant that's going to produce a lot of blooms, I'm going to put several clumps into one pot. But this makes it a little easier once I separate it all apart. And I really do, you know, cleaning it like this is really important because you want to get all these hiding places for scale. I have a big problem with scale insects on my Cymbidium. And by pulling off all these old dead leaves and cleaning it up, then they have less places to hide. And then if I do use a treatment like an oil or soap to clean up the scale, then it's more effective if they're not all hiding underneath. Well, there are a lot of ants. You probably don't notice that on TV, that this pot was filled with Argentine ants. Proof positive they don't bite because they haven't bitten me yet. Okay, so that's a nice clump. This could be cleaned up a little more. Okay, how about this clump? Let's see. Okay, so you know what I end up doing now is combining these two clumps together, like this, and then putting them into a pot like this. Now, what I'm going to do is give myself a little more space to work. Here we go. Now what we need is the mix, and I've brought some mix here. Now if you noticed, when you were looking at this, it was mostly filled with roots at this point, and I'm just going to keep pushing this over here, get that out of my way, and what I like to use is just a small 3 or 4 inch pot, and before I do that, I'm going to let me do this real quick. Put out some more newspaper. If you notice, I put newspaper out on the table to try and make it easier to clean up my mess when I'm done. So you set newspaper out. In this case, it'll cover up all those ants that are crawling all over the place. Let's set that out. And I want to just show you the potting mix. This is Cymbidium mix. And I get this from Nursery in San Gabriel Valley. Actually, this is San Gabriel Nursery. And take a look at this. Let's see. Can we go overhead and take a look at it? And you can see what it's made up of. Okay, it's a medium sized bark, and then the white is perlite. And this doesn't look like this mix has any charcoal, but often you'll have chunks of charcoal about the same size as the bark, and you might also have some humus. And if we move this apart, you might well see that there's probably humus. Now, it's about 80% bark, maybe 10% perlite, and maybe 10% humus, something on that range. It's mostly bark, and this drains very, very fast. And that orchids really need that really high rate of drainage. They need that. They really are mostly epiphytic. And now, let's see how they're going to do. I go ahead and I just set these in the middle, like this. And then I put some here. Some there. Constantly. Now, what you can do is you can grab all these leaves, hold them as a clump. Now, let's force them in. Spread this around. To tap it, to settle it. Pour a little more in. I buy my Cymbidium X in large 2-cubic-foot bags. Rather than small ones, so I have quite a few Cymbidiums. Over the years, I've collected a lot of them. Some of my family members are very fond of them, and so when they bloom, I'll bring them into the house. And they can be kind of large plants. This one looks like a smaller variety. That last little on this, so I don't know the name of it, but you don't have to know the name of a plant to enjoy a beautiful flower. Now they're all over me. Now, at this point, you need to be able to pack this in really tight. Now, you can either use like a cut-off broom handle or let's move some stuff around so you get better space. There we go. So now, I'm going to go ahead and stand up. Hopefully, I don't lose my microphone. And let's go to above. And I'm going to use this glass to just press this in and pack it in real tight. Now, I also use broom handles. Broom handles in here are a little piece of, like a 1x1 piece of wood. You want that to be packed in pretty tight. There you go. Now there's a little fertilizer already in the mix. So you don't need to fertilize it right now. You won't need to fertilize this for about 1 month. The best time to repot your Cymbidiums is right after they bloom. So this is not the best time to repot them. But this one wasn't, I didn't think this was in very poor condition. I didn't think it was even going to bloom fully. And I don't see any grass forming on it, any flower buds forming on it. So I go ahead and repot it. Now, if you end up with a bunch of these guys, then typically if you've got, maybe you've got 50 of these guys, I've got 30 to 50 of them, although maybe I'm down to 30. I'm trying to reduce the number of that because it's just too many to deal with, and I don't have time to take care of them the way I should. But then you can repot a third of them every year, and then that'll be, you can be repotting every 3 years. If you only have a couple, then you don't have to worry about that because you just repot it as soon as the plant fills the pot. And that's just about right. And then I would give this good water. I would drench it real good. And then I would set it in a shady location. And I would let it, I wouldn't water it again for a while. I wouldn't water it again for probably about 2 to 4 weeks. Probably water it about every 2 weeks for a little while. And as soon as I see any new growth, then I'll go back to a regular watering schedule, which would be in the winter about once a week, and in the summer about twice a week. In the hottest part of the summer, you can water 3 times a week. You want to water until the water drains out the bottom of the pot. This is not a plant that you would call a low water use. It is a high water use plant, but it is nowhere near as high water use as a lawn, which uses a tremendous amount of water. They can actually go dry for several weeks. It won't hurt them too much. So if you didn't have plants like this and you went off on vacation for a couple of weeks, you wouldn't have to worry about it too much. They don't eat, you know, you can still water them once a week, even in the summer. That would be probably enough. But you want to take a look and see if the bulbs are shriveling. If they're shriveling up, the new growth, then you're not watering enough. And again, cymbidians. Bright light, but shaded in the afternoon. No direct sun on a hot, sunny afternoon. They may not flower as well for you right along the coast, because they actually require hot days in the fall, hot days and cool nights in order to set the flower bulbs. I've been told that they don't flower all that well in Hawaii right along the coast because of that, and I wonder if that might occur here as well. I'm not going to bother to repot this other one because I think you saw how it's done. So you really have to find that crease somewhere in the pot, and with hand shears, might pull it apart, cut through that main root, break it up, and then shake off all the old mix. Remove as many back bulbs as you feel is necessary. You want to keep at least 3 bulbs for when you're repotting. I'll make up 2 or 3 clumps from a big old plant, clean them all up, and then put them all back together either in the same pot or a slightly larger pot. I usually grow my plants in a very large pot. How did I manage not to have that pot? Oh, it's all the way over there. some people grow their cymbidiums in large tubs, you know, and I used to have quite a few of those, and they were just too big for me. I mean, I can handle them. They're not too heavy or anything, but they're bulky. They were difficult to deal with. They use a lot of mix. I had too many plants to begin with. So now I'm going to smaller pots, usually about a 3-gallon pot, 8-inch, 10-inch is about the biggest pot I've got. And one of the things that some people like to do is drill holes in their pots. And so let's take a look at this pot. And this is about as big a pot as I would ever use. In fact, I tend not to even use a pot this big. This is a pretty good-sized pot. I'd say that's at least 12-inch pot. And you can see what's happened is now this, I didn't do this. This was actually done by another grower. He took a regular pot and he drilled all these holes in it to increase his air circulation around the roots. And when you do this, then your mix will actually last longer. It won't stay wet as long. You may have to water more frequently. But then this allows you to really, the 3-year repotting schedule works really well. Some people, if they use a solid pot, would then want to use a 2-year repotting schedule. I think a 3-year potting schedule is fine, regardless of pot you use. But this is kind of a trick to increase your drainage and increase the air around the roots. And orchids love that. This wouldn't be the best idea for other types of plants you grow in pots. With standard kind of normal, what we think of as normal roots. But when you're dealing with orchids, you know, you got to think, really, they're mostly epiphytic. They grow in the branches of trees, they're on trees, in the upper top of the canopy, where they get bright light, but not direct sun. And the roots are mostly just holding the plant up. So this is a trick if you want to, you know, imagine doing this to a lot of pots, it's a lot of work. So I just wanted to show you that. This is as big a pot as I would ever use. In fact, rarely use it that size anymore. So now let's take a quick look at some of the colors that cymbidiums come in. Let's take a look at some more photographs of cymbidiums. Let's look at number 10. bring that up full screen. And so you can see Cymbidium's throw a big spike with a long spray of flowers. Now, this one was allowed to kind of grow sideways. It wasn't tied straight up like I did on that other one. And then if we go to, this one is actually called Best Pink. This is Charlise Alton Best Pink. And so that's a real pretty variety. And this, of course, is the lip. And here are the two petals, and here are the three sepals. And the sepals, of course, cover it up. And these things are really, really delicious to snails and slugs. And so those small buds can be chewed on by snails and slugs. They really will really ruin the flower for you. And then here's another hybrid. It's number 12. Let's look at that. So give you an idea of what Cymbidium. This is again a spike that's been allowed to grow sideways. And then let's take a look at number 13. And you can see this is a white Cymbidium. This is probably a pretty large tub. If you've got a spot in your garden that's just right for Cymbidiums, then a tub would be really good. But this is actually taken inside of a conservatory or an atrium. And then this spike has been tied up here. You can see the stake right there. So this, you know, they grow a wonderful show. Most of my Cymbidiums bloom in the spring. I don't have a lot of varieties that bloom in this time of year, start putting on spikes, will bloom before Christmas. Even though sometimes I buy them when they're blooming around this time of year, they end up blooming in the spring anyway. Let's see if I can discourage those ants from bugging me. So, there you go. Now, Cymbidiums, I do fertilize mine with just a 20-20-20 once a month, if I can, I don't forget. Then I try and leach them heavily, periodically, especially if I see a lot of tip burn. Now, another tip on your orchids, and let's bring up one of the pictures of Phalaenopsis. And I want to just comment on one of the things that viruses do to orchids. We need one. Okay, let's bring this up full screen. Now, you can see the intricate pattern that's on this flower is... And what will happen if it gets infected with a virus is these lines, like this line here, all these dots, instead of being like that, it'll do like this. It'll be all swirled and deformed. In fact, the petal, instead of having a nice, having symmetric, both sides being the same, you know, this may be all contorted like this, and then you get swirls all in here. And that's what viruses do to the flower. They ruin the flower. Now, viruses are very host specific. You know, one of the common viruses, of course, is the Cymbidium mosaic virus. And if you get it, you really ought to just throw that plant away entirely. The danger is, and it happens all the time, is when you're pruning, you get the virus particles on your pruning shears, and then if you go prune another plant, you move it from plant to plant. And that's why you always clean your shears between each plant. And of course, some viruses are actually used intentionally to cause that color break or that swirl in the flower, like in camellias and in tulips. They intentionally virus them. They'll take a white flower, white-flowered camellia, and they'll virus it, and then you'll get this white swirl all through the petal. It looks beautiful. It's fabulous. But that's, you're dealing with a pure red flower or flower that's not that complex, and it actually enhances the appearance of the flower. Orchids are already very, very complex flowers with very ornate patterns, and any change in that ruins the flower. So viruses are terrible for orchids, and it's not worth keeping virus orchids. You should throw them away. At the least, segregate them from all your plants so they're not in with the clean plants. I remember when I was at the Huntington, we received a big donation of orchids, and, probably several thousand from a grower who no longer wanted his plants. And the question is, what should we do with these orchids? If we had tested every single one of them, it runs around $5 to $10 to test an orchid to see if it's infected with the virus. By the time we did that, we just spent Say if we did that for, you know, $5 for 1,000 plants, we spent $5,000 testing all those plants to see if they're infected. So instead of spending, you know, $5,000 and buy you a lot of plants that you know are clean from nurseries or by species, and of course, when you're a botanical garden, you need to have a collections policy. And do you want to, you can't collect every single plant on earth, you can't collect every orchid on earth. So what are you going to collect? You need a policy. So a lot of the botanical gardens collect species, and they're not as interested in the hybrids and the showy cultivars as they are in collecting species orchids. And so instead of spending $5,000 to test that whole collection, that collection was then grown over several years, allowed to flower, and then just on visual inspection, some of the plants were retained because they appeared to be clean. They didn't show any leaf infections. They didn't show any color break. So we were pretty sure they were virus-free. And they were cultivars or species that we were interested in keeping in the collection. But the rest of them were sold at the plant sale. Whether they were virus or not, we didn't know if they were virus. But so anytime you have orchids in your collection, keep a close eye on them. Look for any black spots on the leaves. Look for any color break in the petals of the flowers, where the color swirls or is different. Because really, if you look at this one here behind me, it's very uniform. Both sides are nearly identical. It's nearly, they're mirror images of each other. So if one side is quite a bit different than the other, it's all swirled and not uniform the way this flower is, that's an indication that it's been infected with a virus. And not only, you know, there are probably a good 10 to 15 different viruses that are fairly common in orchids, and most of them are mechanically transmissible, which means that if you get the virus particles on your shears and then go prune a healthy plant, you'll move it from plant to plant. Not all viruses are mechanically transmissible. The rose virus is not mechanically transmissible, so you don't need to do that with your roses when you're pruning your roses. You're not going to move the virus that infects roses from plant to plant on your shears. That's only, you only get virus orchids, I mean roses, when you propagate from an infected orchid. I mean rose. Confusing myself. So today's topic has been orchids, and we didn't get a lot of calls in today, but if you have any questions about your orchids, or if you take a look at them during the week, you can always call us next Sunday, and we'll do our best to answer your questions. What's really nice about orchids now is their price has come way down from many years ago. They're really too expensive, and you can get some, and they flower for months. And then you can get them to repeat bloom and grow them just the right spot. This has been Gardens of California. My name is Gerald Ferry. And thank you for viewing the show. I hope we will see you next week.